Good evening, and welcome to The Collegium, our monthly magazine program in three parts: cinema, state of affairs, and arts calendar. Our cinema presentation tonight is Act of War. Our state of affairs will have interviews with Olaf Van Dunen, Charles Achie Odong, and Temba Kadali. Last but not least, our guest artist, Angela Kramer, performing Triptych, a dedication to soul, gospel, and jazz as interpreted through dance. Once again, we say to you, welcome, and remember, you are participating in The Collegium.
Ancient stories tell of the origins of our cosmos, the hot, fiery earth turning against the changing sky. From the union of Papa, our earth mother, and Wakea, our sky father, comes everything in our world.
Night and you,
the sea and all its creatures,
and blue Hawaii,
the islands that we call Hawaii,
the night is heavenly,
the taro, our sustaining food,
and you are heaven to me,
and Kanaka Maoli, the real people of this land.
Lovely you,
we are one with our earth,
blue Hawaii,
living, communicating, conscious.
All this loveliness,
we cherish and care for the land, for it gives us life.
Come with me.
Keep all your lands and all your hands.
While the moon is on the sea.
We can live on the streets. We don't have a house.
The night is young, and so are we.
What the hell is you guys behind me? I'm 1998.
So are we.
Thank you, Senator Malay. Thank you, Governor Ariyoshi.
Dreams come true. And mine could all come true this magic night of nights with
you.
We are the Hawaiian people. These islands have always been our home. We were sovereign over this land before there was an England, long before there was a United States. By the 19th century, our independent nation was recognized by the dominant powers of the world. And in 1893, in an act of war, in an armed invasion, and in violation of international law, our nation was taken. And we have been compelled, against our right to self-determination, to become United States citizens.
We are not American! We are not American! We are not American! We will die as Hawaiians! We will never be Americans!
Hawaiian civilization was developed to a very high state because Hawaiians had to live in an island ecosystem and take care of it. They cultivated both dry land and wetland taro, and they literally farmed the seas with fish ponds. Sharing became a mark of civilized behavior because there was so much food available. If you live in a relatively small environment, you develop an economy of agriculture, an economy of fishing, an economy of sailing, of harvesting the uplands. You have no alternative. In order to feed a large population, you must economize.
Because the society was so well organized, people only had to put 4 hours a day into food production. They had a lot of leisure time, and some of the leisure time they used to create great works of art. The greatest chanting and hula that we see, wonderful surfing contests, wonderful feats of physical prowess.
Sleek, streamlined canoes with which Hawaiians made these long voyages from hemisphere to hemisphere.
I wouldn't want to say to you it was a perfect life, but it was one that we understood and that we enjoyed.
Into the relative bliss of ancient Hawaiian society comes the British. And when they enter Hawaii, the Hawaiians are astounded.
He kanaka keukeu. They are white men with loose skins, angular heads.
The British, for their part, see the Hawaiians and are also astounded.
These are certainly the most industrious people I ever saw. They have brought their agriculture to an incredible degree of perfection.
The utmost attention to cleanliness prevails.
They are fair and honest in all their intercourse.
So, when Captain Cook arrived in 1778 on his two ships, the Resolution and Discovery, he realized he had come upon a remarkably robust, healthy, and flourishing people.
These chiefs were men of strong and well-proportioned bodies and of countenances remarkably pleasing.
And of course, Captain Cook was well aware that his men carried infectious diseases.
The diseases that the British left, tuberculosis, syphilis, gonorrhea, lasted for decades and visited upon the Hawaiian people, a scourge that they never recovered from.
The dead fell like dried kukui twigs tossed down by the wind. 100 were stricken in a day. Scarcely 1 out of 10 lived.
The effect on the population was collapse. Not a population decline, but a population collapse. That collapse makes it impossible to reconcile your spiritual world or your political world or your economic world. Everything is chaotic.
All of these things have led to changes in the air which we breathe, the coming of things which weaken the body, changes in plant life, changes in religion, changes in the art of healing, and changes in the laws by which the land is governed.
Calvinists, let's look at Calvinists a little bit. Of all the religions that came into the Pacific and all the missionaries that came, Calvinists were probably the worst. Coming out of New England, which is a very cold place where people have a very severe attitudes towards one another, these Calvinists didn't like dancing in any form. They didn't like European dancing. They thought it was a terrible thing. They didn't allow dancing. They didn't celebrate Christmas. They didn't celebrate birthdays. They didn't celebrate any aspect of life. They were very somber.
The appearance of destitution, degradation, and barbarism among the chattering and almost naked savages was appalling. Can these be human beings?
Do they not form a link in creation, connecting man with the brute?
So their goal was to civilize us, to bring us out of barbarism and paganism up to a level of civilization as they saw it.
And they want to institute a New England way of living so that the women must sew, the printing presses must roll, and Hawaiians must sing hymns and recite scripture.
You must dress like foreigners do. You must eat what foreigners eat. You must farm the way foreigners farm. You must forget your dances and your traditions. In addition, the Calvinists said the reason you are dying is because you do not believe in Jehovah.
They enter this mass death scene. They bring an explanation, and they offer a form of salvation. The form of salvation is olaho, everlasting life. So they convert because they believe it will guarantee everlasting life. Of course, it does not. The conversion numbers go up, but the population numbers continue to decline.
Ke kunei naluakini, We build churches, labor day and night, but the land has become empty. The old villages lie silent in a tangle of bushes and vines, haunted by ghosts and horned owls, frequented by goats and bats.
It is impossible to estimate too highly the value and importance of the Sandwich Islands.
The islands lie in the course of the great trade between North America and Eastern Asia.
It would be highly injurious to our interests if they should be seized by Great Britain or France.
It is the key to the dominion of the American Pacific.
Official American policy in the 1840s reflected this move for taking Hawaii when the President of the United States, Tyler, enunciates the Tyler Doctrine, in essence, a Pacific version of the Monroe Doctrine. It was a message that the American president was sending to Britain and France, telling them, this is not your arena. We, the United States, have this arena. While the Americans are doing this, they're also continuing to dispossess and remove American Indians on the American continent. They're also continuing their genocidal campaigns against the Indian tribes. So this is a simultaneous grab for power. Americans are moving across the continent in North America as they are moving out into the Pacific.
Many more foreigners came to live in Hawaii as businessmen, and they were constantly pressuring the chiefs for private ownership of land. The chiefs resisted this idea because traditionally, land was like water or air to be used communally. But missionaries warned the chiefs that if Hawaiians did not own their land according to Western land tenure, then they would lose the land. This had been happening throughout the Pacific as Britain and France took over Australia, New Zealand, and Tahiti. Finally, in 1848, the chiefs reluctantly agreed to the privatization of land, called the Mahele, or land division. For the first time, land could be bought and sold.
There are a great many foreigners arriving to take up lands, and soon all the lands will be acquired by them. If this be the Lord's will, it may not be ere long before I acquire some for myself.
The missionaries began to buy large tracts of land, leaving the church and becoming merchants. Some today are multinational corporations. And the Land Commission, run by missionaries, gave land awards to only 10% of the common people. These awards averaged 3 acres apiece.
In September 1848, an American warship brought the disease known as measles to Hilo, Hawaii. It spread and carried away about a third of the population.
As foreigners were allowed to own land, they came to make great sugar plantations, and great fortunes were being made.
These fellows do not think they have done much unless they make a yearly profit of 100%. If a native was stubborn and held on to his land, they would surround him with their plantations and squeeze him out.
And as the sugar factors, ex-missionaries, gathered more lands under their control, the question immediately arose as to a reciprocity treaty with the United States. The United States resisted this for a long time.
Certainly the sugar growers of the South did not want to have sugar from Hawaii competing with their own sugar.
So if they were going to give up their competitive edge, they wanted something. And that something was the Pearl River Lagoon, otherwise known as Pearl Harbor.
May 8, 1873, Secretary of War, Washington, D.C. Sir, in compliance with your confidential instructions, we have visited the Sandwich Islands and ascertained the defensive capabilities of their different ports. Pearl River Harbor would seem to have the necessary properties to be converted into a good harbor of refuge. It could be completely defended by inexpensive batteries. Its waters are deep enough for the largest vessels of war.
Once General Schofield and the American military began to think of Pearl Harbor as a place that they could call their own, the idea of annexation of Hawaii to America became much more interesting to the American Congress.
Hawaiians at that time were greatly upset by this.
There is a feeling of bitterness against these rude people who dwell upon our land and have high-handed ideas of giving away somebody else's property as if it was theirs. My blood boils with resentment against this insult.
Harper's Weekly, December 26, 1874. King David Kalakaua, who was now on a visit to this country, is a man of good education, determined to preserve the independence of the islands over which he rules.
When Kalakaua went to Washington, D.C. to negotiate the Treaty of Reciprocity, he caused quite a stir because he was very gracious, handsome, he addressed the Congress.
Although well disposed toward Americans, Kalakaua was strongly opposed to the cession of Pearl Harbor to this country for use as a naval station.
The Reciprocity Treaty is signed, and immediately after that, sugar exports to the United States increase astronomically. The number of sugar plantations soar and increase the demand for labor. Immigrants flooded into Hawaii, and between 1877 and 1890, there is an increase of immigrants to 55,000 new immigrants, a 33% increase. At the same time, the native population, because of disease and dispossession, continues its downward decline.
It is a question of only a few generations before the Hawaiians will be only a memory.
I believe that if I shall make the main object of my reign the increase of the nation, there may be secured both the stability of the government and the national independence.
So Kalakaua's motto was Ho'olulahui, that is, to increase, to invigorate, proliferate the Hawaiian people. Of course, he revived our chants, our dance, our hula, our religious practices, and our traditional medical practices.
A retrograde step of heathenism and a disgrace to the age.
Kalakaua believed that in order to maintain Hawaiian independence, Hawaii had to project a strong image abroad. And so Kalakaua spent a lot of his administration in the years that he was king really trying to project that image. He tried to sign an Asian Federation Treaty with the Emperor in Japan. He tried to sign a Polynesian Federation Treaty with Malietoa in Samoa. He did what he could to tell other people in the world that Hawaii was a force to be reckoned with.
The little kingdom occupies an honored position in the family of nations, having treaty relations with all the commercial nations of the earth, and being a member of the Universal Postal Union with a representative in the Congress at Geneva. The standard of intelligence among the native Hawaiians is higher than that in any other nation in the world, illiteracy being practically unknown.
By this time, many Hawaiians had learned the Hale system. They could understand and were educated in that system. By bringing them into the government, Kalakaua earned the wrath of the missionary gang.
It is best to speak plainly. It is not a question of race, but of fitness. Let the native qualify himself for high office.
It wasn't that the Haoles were afraid that their expertise was not needed. It was that they were afraid that their influence was on the wane.
I do solemnly promise upon my honor that I will keep secret the existence and purposes of this league to protect the white community of this kingdom.
The Hawaiian League is essentially a group of white Americans who want annexation. And they have a little thug subgroup called the Honolulu Rifles.
This organization came to number some 400 men, really the most disciplined and powerful armed force in Honolulu.
And they, together with Lauren Thurston, the most vociferous
annexationist leader, decide that they are going to promulgate a new constitution and force it on Kalākaua, essentially at gunpoint. This constitution, which has come to be known by Hawaiians, rightly so, as the Bayonet Constitution, essentially, in one fell swoop, disenfranchises Hawaiians of political power. This constitution allowed all foreigners the right to vote if they had money. And because of the property qualification for voting, it took power away from the common Hawaiian, who was generally landless, who was generally without money, who could not meet the property qualifications. It was not enough that the Haole controlled the plantations. It was not enough that they were making more profit. It was not enough that they had most of the arable land in Hawaii. No, they wanted to have control of the legislature. And their whole push in this period of time was to replace democratic native voting with oligarchic white missionary dominance. Kalākaua becomes ill, and he leaves for San Francisco, and he dies there in 1891. His sister, Liliʻuokalani, has been named in the Constitution as his successor. Liliʻuokalani is, for Hawaiians today and for Hawaiians then, a wonderfully Hawaiian personage. She is, for example, a great musician. She is a composer. She has over 300 songs to her credit, including some of the most famous songs in Hawaiian culture, like Aloha Oe, which is really a love song. But she was also something of a feminist. She had proposed, for example, that there be a women's bank. She was very concerned to support destitute native children. And she brings to bear on this problem of her people's dispossession politically all of the grace and all of the understanding of a chiefly woman who has been trained for politics.
When Liliʻuokalani came to power in 1891, almost the first thing that she did was to take a tour of the islands. And wherever she went, there were representatives from all walks of society, basically, who came to her and said, we need a new constitution.
Petitions poured in from every part of the islands for a new constitution. To have ignored so general a request, I must be deaf to the voice of the people, which tradition tells us is the voice of God.
Immediately then, as soon as she takes office, she asserts herself. She decides that she will take a stand for her people, she will inaugurate a new constitution, and therein lies the whole tale of the overthrow. Unfortunately for Liliʻuokalani, the U.S. minister to the kingdom at the time was John L. Stevens.
Americanize the islands, assume control of the crown lands, and the result soon will be a civilization which will make the islands like Southern California.
Basically, Stevens saw it almost as a holy mission to see Hawaii safely encircled by American arms.
The time is near when we must decide who shall hold these islands as a part of their national territory.
He believed very strongly that America needed the Hawaiian Islands in order to expand.
The Hawaiians looked upon him as an unschooled buffoon, not dangerous, but certainly very rude. This, of course, was really, in many ways, an error, because Stevens was very dangerous.
The monarchy now was only an impediment to good government.
He was the U.S. minister, an accredited U.S. minister to the Kingdom of Hawaii. His job was to carry on with the treaty agreements that had been made between the Kingdom of Hawaii and the government of America.
The Queen and her faction will have to yield. Otherwise, the entire overthrow of the monarchy could not be long delayed.
You're really looking at somebody who's just basically a spy. He was reporting back to a specific constituency in Washington. He was a close friend of James Blaine, who was the Secretary of State under the Harrison administration. They were operating their own agenda.
the golden hour is near at hand.
Part of the intimidation that the Hawaiian subjects were feeling was the constant presence of U.S. military.
When you get into the 1880s and 1890s, there's almost always an American warship in Hawaiian waters. They are rotated through. One will leave, another one takes its place.
As soon as the USS Boston is ready for sea, proceed to Honolulu and report to the Commander-in-Chief, Pacific Station.
The United States in the 1880s embarked on a shipbuilding program. It was part of the general naval arms buildup in the period. Look at the Boston, which was completed in 1887. This was a state-of-the-art battleship.
The main battery consists of two 8-inch central pivot high-powered guns mounted in echelon and six 6-inch high-powered guns mounted in broadside pivots, rapid-fire guns, revolving cannon, Gatling
guns. This was the kind of symbol of American power that was anchored in Honolulu Harbor when the Queen was overthrown.
Remain at Honolulu until further orders.
The fear that this lodged in the heart of Hawaiians, particularly in the sovereign, Lili'u, must have been tremendous. That was, I think, a real testament to her courage.
And what she basically had to contend with was the Annexation Club, a group of people who were involved in the sugar industry and related industries like banking or shipping, whose express purpose essentially is to rid the kingdom of monarchy, rid the kingdom of independence, and hand it over to the United States. One of the first things they did was they consulted with John Stevens.
It was common talk that plotting accompanied dining at the United States legation on Nu'uanu Street.
And John Stevens essentially told them,
should a revolutionary attempt be made, it would begin by the seizure of the police station, the royal palace, and the government buildings.
There's no question here about his intentions. He's basically coaching them along. John Stevens is intimately associated with the conspiracy to overthrow the Queen.
In 1892, the Annexation Club sends Lauren Thurston, the arch-annexationist, to Washington, D.C. to lobby.
Welcome back to the Collegium. We're very pleased tonight to have as our first guest Mr. Hola Fantunen. Hola Fantunen, welcome to the Collegium. Could you tell us a little bit about the production that you company that you began begun, which is entitled Yobantu Video Productions?
Well, Yobantu Video Production is a black team in Berlin, and our focus is the aspect of black life.
You've also been a very busy fellow, because I understand there's another initiative you've undertaken. You and a very good colleague of ours, Dr. Timba Kadali, and it's entitled The International Information Exchange Concerning Issues Regarding the African Diaspora. What a monumental project. Could you tell us about it?
Yeah, we saw that we had a problem about the information that had been spread in Berlin. We saw that many people did not know what kind of activities had been done in Berlin. So we faced this problem and decided to spread information not only in Berlin but also outside of Berlin, means in Germany, Europe, and worldwide.
Could you tell us a little bit about the activities, the research that's gone into making this project a reality? What have you done so far, and at what stage or what level is the project at this present point?
So we have collected much addresses, as much as we can, in Berlin, Germany, Europe, and states of Africa, also the states in America. And we will contact them and provide them with information regarding the activities of the African diaspora.
What form will this information take? Will it be audio tapes and videotapes or written material, or what do you have in mind?
So we thought about broadcasting stations in form of radio, because the radio is a good mean and is cost effective. And we also thought about videotapes, but the main goal is radio, I would say.
And tell us, how will you assemble the information to send abroad, to send to these radio stations? How will you collect this information?
Well, this information have to be collected in a disk, because now we have the year 1996, and we cannot allow to have written papers. So we asked all people who want to disseminate informations regarding their activities, we asked them to send us their discs.
There is probably a designated point, a couple of people, and perhaps some telephone numbers that you could give us. Would you be so kind as to give our audience that information?
Okay, if you want to contact us, please send your information to The Collegium, Anthony Phillips. His telephone number is 030-251-3864. Or Marion Kramer, her telephone number is 030-751-8438. Or if you have an email address, you could also contact Mr. Phillips by jumpernt.online.de.
Thank you very much. Ola van Doenen. Welcome back to the Collegium and the second portion of our State of Affairs program. We're very pleased tonight to have as our panelists Dr. Temba Kadali and Mr. Charles Echie Odom. Charles, let me begin with you. Since the turn of the century, we have witnessed many civil wars in Africa. Both one might term one period might have been the colonialism period, we could say generally, and there are others who feel that after that we have entered a period of a neo-colonialism. There, that is perhaps open to discussion. But certainly, I would like for you to inform us as to how do you analyze and what are the causes of this constant upheaval that Africa seems to face?
Well, today as we speak, everybody knows there is turmoil in eastern part of Zaire, and this has been causing concern to a lot of people, not only in Africa, in Europe, in America. All peace-loving people all over the world are concerned with this crisis. Your question as to origin of all this civil strife. Let's go back to the first part of your question. Yes, Africa was colonized, and we had our struggles to end colonialism. And these were struggles that were easy to understand. It was clear we had the bad guys on one side and the good guys fighting for freedom on one side. In recent times, however, there has emerged more civil strife. We have problems that have been going on in the Sudan, for example. We have problems that have been going on in Liberia, which have been of concern to the international community. Now, why are these problems there today? One could perhaps mention that these are problems that may be attributed to social injustice, lack of human rights. You talked about colonialism. Another part which is tied to the recent problems, the problems that we have in Rwanda, as we know, the Tutsis in eastern Zaire have mentioned that the colonial masters did not care about peoples. Borders were set arbitrarily. So we have Tutsis in Zaire, we have Tutsis in Rwanda, we have some Tutsis in Uganda, we have also some Tutsis in Tanzania. So that people are trying to find means of coming together again. We also have problems that one could also mention is causing these civil wars. This is a problem of poverty. Africa is becoming poorer and poorer, and the many people who don't seem to see any hope whatsoever. On top of that, we also have a situation where democracy, as we know it today, is becoming very elusive in Africa, such that we have many people who do not understand or do not have any hope or any other means of changing their governments.
Temba, I'd like to ask you about the, could you analyze and tell us a little bit about the effects of the Million Man March, and what is the current information on this event?
Sure. Before I answer the question, maybe we should spend some time on the social and historic background of that event. In October 1995, a public convention took place in the United States in Washington of African men, people of African descent, Native American, but also Hispanic. And this event is known as the Million Man March. The idea, as far as I can remember, was brought up by Elijah Muhammad in the 60s, who was the leader of the Nation Islam, of Islam that time. And the idea has been revived in the 90s on the African-American Leadership Summit by Minister Louis Farrakhan, who is the leader of the Nation of Islam today. I think that the situation of people of African descent worldwide is rather critical. It's like that 40 to 70% of the children are brought up in so-called single family units, meaning that there is no male around, no father who is an educator or an economic provider, no role model, more or less. The march serves more or less as a platform, irrespective of the philosophical belief of people, irrespective of their religious denomination. It serves as a platform for men to confess to their responsibilities and take over those responsibilities in their communities. It also serves as a vehicle for building an infrastructure for the African diaspora on an international level. The continuation of that march can be seen in the so-called Day of Atonement, which took place in October this year in New York, and it will take place from 95 on every year. I think that men all around the world have been inspired through that and put up events of similar kind, similar shape. Now, what is the current situation concerning the update of the march? One thing can be said, a children adoption program has been set up for children who should be adopted, and the Million Man March serves as a network for that, so that people can contact institutions to adopt children. Second, an international banking system has been set up or is on the way as work in progress through the board of the Million Man March. And third, we can also probably see the drop of crime rate in the United States as an effect of that march, where millions of people took place and their families were involved as well. By the way, it is more or less the greatest peaceful convention ever in the annals of human existence.
Charles, in relationship to what you've talked about the poverty of Africa, what is the relationship between African countries and the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank?
Ah, that is another interesting question. The history of the International Monetary Fund and also the World Bank, generally, they've been around for 50 years. During their first 30 years or so, they concentrated their activities in rebuilding Europe. The conditions they set for the countries in Europe at that time were excellent, and the result is seen in the reconstruction of Europe, which was extremely fast. Now, if you go to Africa today, the IMF and the World Bank are the only major source of foreign aid. Now, I would like to address this issue from the ordinary person's point of view. the ordinary people in Africa welcome this assistance from the World Bank, from IMF. But they would like the World Bank, the IMF, to take into account their own economic situation. Because many times, the result has been that the poor people become poorer and poorer.
I think we would like to cover these situations a little bit more. We've come on to the end of our time here in the State of Affairs, but on our next program, we would like to continue the description of the relationship between the IMF and the World Bank to Africa. And we would also like to deal on our next program with a question that of the status of the people that are so-called Afro-Germans that exist here in Berlin and in Germany today. We want to tell you that you are participating in the Collegium. We'll be right back with our arts calendar.
Singing Mary, oh Mary, don't you weep. Martha don't have to mourn.
Oh Martha, don't you mourn.
Listen
don't
to me, Mary.
Oh Mary, don't you weep.
Martha don't have to mourn.
Oh Martha, don't you mourn.
Pharaoh's army,
oh, Mary, don't you weep.
They got drowned in the sea
down
one day.
The
but Jesus said, Mary.
Oh Mary,
your little sister don't have to mourn,
oh,
no more.
Martha, don't you mourn.
Now can I get a witness? He said, Mary,
oh, Mary, don't you weep.
Martha don't have to mourn.
Oh, Martha, don't you mourn.
It may be somebody
oh,
sick oh, today.
Mary,
if somebody here ain't got no home.
Oh, Martha, don't you
but listen, Pharaoh's
oh,
army,
oh,
they got drowned in the sea one day. But I believe a man said, me,
oh, baby, don't you weep.
Your little sister don't have to mourn no
oh,
more.
Martha, don't you mourn.
Now listen, if I could right
yeah,
now,
I
want to tell you that I surely would now.
Oh,
put my foot on the rock, children.
Yeah,
stand on the rock where Moses stood
oh,
one day. Because Pharaoh's eye,
oh,
that's what the Bible said, got drowned in the sea. But I believe the man said,
Mary. He said, Mary. He said, Mary.
Trouble in the land will be all over after a while. You won't have to give up right for wrong no more. And maybe it could have been a little hard to hear. And I believe Jesus said, I better call a little bit louder.
Oh, Mary, don't you
wish I had somebody to help me call me.
Oh, Mary, don't you
yeah, Mary.
Oh, Mary, don't you
yeah, Mary.
Oh, Mary.
I'll be a bridge over deep water if you trust in my name.
Oh, Mary.
I'll be a rock in the weary land.
Oh, Mary, don't you oh, Mary, don't you
I don't believe she hides you. You better call
Mary,
her again. Tell Martha don't have to mourn
oh,
no more.
Good morning, heartache. You old gloomy sight. Good morning, heartache. Thought we said goodbye last night. I tossed and turned until it seemed that you had gone. But here you are with the dawn. Who wish I'd forget you, but you're here to stay. Yeah. It seems I met you when my love had gone away. Day out just by saying to you, good morning, heartache, what's new? Good morning.